Good morning. The Mass today is for Charlie Akira, an anniversary Mass requested by his wife Bev and their family. We celebrate today the third Sunday of the Easter cycle, the entrance antiphon. Cry out with joy to God on the earth, O sing to the glory of his name, O render him glorious praise. Alleluia.
Thank you.
May your people exalt forever, O Lord, and renew youthfulness of spirit, so that rejoicing now in the bestowed glory of our adoption, we may look forward in confident hope to the rejoicing day of holy resurrection. And all this through our Lord, Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
The first reading is a reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Then Peter stood up with the 11, raised his voice, and proclaimed, "You who are Jews, indeed all of you staying in Jerusalem, let this be known to you, and listen to my words. You who are Israelites, hear these words. Jesus the Nazarene was the man commended to you by God with mighty deeds, wonders, and signs, which God worked through him in your midst, as you yourselves know. This man, delivered up by the set plan and foreknowledge of God, you killed, using lawless men to crucify him. But God raised him up, releasing him from the throes of death, because it was impossible for him to be held by it. For David says of him, 'I saw the Lord ever before me. With him at my right hand, I shall not be disturbed. Therefore, my heart has been glad, and my tongue has exalted. My flesh, too, will dwell in hope, because you will not abandon my soul to the netherworld, nor will you suffer your Holy One to see corruption. You have made known to me the paths of life. You will fill me with joy in your presence.' My brothers, one can confidently say to you about the patriarch David that he died and was buried, and his tomb is in our midst to this day. But since he was a prophet, and knew that God had sworn an oath to him that he would set one of his descendants upon his throne, he foresaw and spoke of the resurrection of the Christ, that neither was he abandoned to the netherworld, nor did his flesh see corruption. God raised this Jesus. Of this we are all witnesses. Exalted at the right hand of God, he received the promise of the Holy Spirit from the Father and poured him forth, as you see and hear." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
St. Peter. Beloved, if you invoke as Father him who judges impartially according to each one's works, conduct yourselves with reverence during the time of your sojourning, realizing that you were ransomed for your futile conduct, handed on by your ancestors, not with perishable things like silver or gold, but with the precious blood of Christ as of a spotless, unblemished lamb. He was known before the foundation of the world, but revealed in the final time for you, who through him believe in God and raised him from the dead and gave him glory, so that your faith and hope are in God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And it happened that while he was with them at table, he took bread said the blessing, broke it, and gave it to them. With that, their eyes were opened. They recognized him, but he vanished from their sight. Then they said each to the other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he spoke to us on the way and opened the scripture to us?" So they set out at once, and they returned to Jerusalem, where they found gathered together the 11, and those with them who were saying, "The Lord has truly been raised. He's appeared to Simon." Then the two recounted what had taken place on the way, and how he was made known to them in the breaking of bread. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
I think it is safe to say that of the post-resurrection appearances of Jesus, and they are mentioned in all of the Gospels, this one from St. Luke is my favorite. It has all the beauty of Luke's storytelling ability, together with action, a well-formed plot, and the gradual revelation of the Christ. It is one of those stories that comes into the mind and then just goes down and touches the heart profoundly. And I suppose because of this, it really has been, over the years, my favorite. And it is a little bit hard to proclaim it without getting caught up into the sacred action. It's been a favorite of mine, as I've said, for many, many years. And I recall another time, and we're going to go into another part of this talk at this moment, because I'm going to talk about a time when I was back in school, and I think it was in high school toward the end, when we had an art appreciation course. And this was one of those courses that started with the pyramids and ended up with Picasso. So you know, there was no depth to it whatsoever. It was one of those marvelous flybys that you get a chance to look, sample, and pick. And one of the sections that we took was on the northern version of the Renaissance. And principally, it talked about Rembrandt van der Rijn. And looking at his work and listening to the teacher explain how he worked with light and shadow and all of that other sort of stuff that was terribly artistic, we saw many of his pictures. And one of them touched the heart, as I said, and it was the Supper at Emmaus. I brought this over here to church today and put it in place in the book. I'm sure the book doesn't mind. And this picture is from 1648, is the picture itself. It's a lovely print. And what this picture depicts is that moment when the disciples realize just who is their guest at supper. And as I said at the beginning, this in the process was a gradual thing. Now, Rembrandt did not start out that way. He went for the big punch at the very first. But as he matured, he sought to present in a more refined way the awareness that people come to. And that is certainly what is going on in this picture here. A few things that might be of interest. If you take a look at the picture, the whole surrounding of it, it's quite improbable The reason I say that is because this is no mere inn, no pub, which the disciples and Jesus have stopped at for a bite to eat and a place for the night. By the very architectural structure in the background, this is what would be called a Roman basilica. Now, a Roman basilica was a law court, and when Constantine approved Christianity, making it a recognized religion, and Christianity gradually took over the empire, some of the law courts were converted into churches, but they retained the title basilica. You can tell that from the columns that are here, and the very fact that all of this space in a typical pub would be wasted. So something more is going on here. Moreover, you can tell that this is a painting of a man from the Northern Renaissance. Rembrandt was one of the few of the Dutch painters who did not go down to Italy, principally Rome, to study the artwork there because he was a good member of his faith, and so he did not go down to Rome, as the other fellows and artists did. But that does not mean that he wasn't influenced by the Italian painters. The hint of influence by Titian can be seen in this large arch, which forms a silhouette in the background. It's that dark background upon which something important is going to happen. And you can also see touches of Caravaggio in his work. Moreover, if you look at the principles themselves, Jesus appears to be the only one who is properly dressed for the occasion. What he is wearing would be worn in the first century AD, or the first century. His companions and the servant, if you look closely at their garments, they don't look like the dress of Jews of the first century. They look more like the 16th, 17th century clothes of people in Holland. Now, being a good Christian, Rembrandt did not exaggerate anything or misrepresent anything in the portraying of Christ. But he did what the Shakespeare plays like to do in modern days. They put Shakespeare into modern dress. So the attendants at this occasion, by the very vesture, would suggest 16th, 17th century Holland. The focal point, the breaking of the bread, is illuminated. There is light coming from the window, but there's a light from another source, and that light is the Christ. Interestingly enough, there is a tablecloth, and then there is this cloth, this large white cloth on top of it, which would, for Catholics, suggest the corporal. The corporal, which is part of the vesting of the very altar that we celebrate at today. All of these things would come together to sort of make a suggestion to the pious Christian looking at it. Jesus Christ, who is in proper vesture, is the same yesterday. The fact that he is taking supper with men who are dressed like the 17th century would, for Rembrandt, say, Jesus Christ is the same today. And for those of us looking back at this painting from the 21st century, we would say, Jesus Christ is the same forever. Now that is not original. That statement is found in the 13th chapter of the book of Hebrews, verse 8.
So all of this surrounds this wonderful moment, in which the Eucharist is made present, in which they realize just who their guest is. And it is because of this moment that I fell in love with this painting, and it adorns my living room at the rectory. But we're not here to talk about my rectory. We're here to talk about the wonderful event itself. And I would like to go back to the very beginning. Don't worry, I'm not going to take too long. And I would like to draw all of this together by describing some things and leading you to see what else is going on. And for this idea, I would like to acknowledge that over the years, having read books by Scott Hahn, something sort of began to ring a little bell. See if that bell sounds for you too. We start at the very beginning where Clopas and his friend are on their way to Emmaus. They had it with Jerusalem. Jesus has been killed. They are in fear, they are in terror, and they're getting out of there. Jesus walks along with them, and the dialogue begins. What are you talking about as you go on your way? And they confess their fears, their doubts, their sadness, their disappointment. Jesus takes them to task as not a severe judge, but as a gentle father, leading them to a new understanding. Does this not have elements of the penitential rite which begins the celebration of every Mass? From there, they move on to the liturgy of the Word, where Luke says that he opened the meaning of the scripture to them, all that pertained to him. So we already have the opening, we have the liturgy of the word, I'm sure with homiletic. And then, as he appears to be going on, they request, stay with us, for the hour is late. And so he goes in. And he is at table with them. And then he takes the bread. Does this not obviously refer to the Eucharist? Jesus celebrates a Eucharist, the first Eucharist since the Holy Resurrection with these two disciples of his. And as they recognize him, he disappears. But they, having learned much, remembered much, taken in the instruction, what do? They do what you and I and every good Catholic, every good Christian should do after we celebrate liturgy. Go out to all the world and proclaim the good news. And the good news is very simple. Jesus Christ, a man approved by God, was put to death by our leaders, but by the grace of God he was raised, and we have seen his glory. And the glory of the Lord now is revealed. Each and every time we gather together in his name and break.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, the maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, consubstantial with the Father, through him all things were made. For us men, for our salvation, he came down from heaven. And by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scripture. He ascends into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sin. I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. And now a prayer of the faithful.
For all who seek truth and for all who guide truth seekers, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For civil authorities and for all who work toward the common good, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the poor, the unemployed, and all who struggle to make ends meet, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who try to walk in the way of the Lord, for all who have strayed from the path, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all present in this holy place, and those with us from home, and for all who recognize the Lord in one another, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the sick of the parish, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the deceased of the parish, especially for Roger Broadhead and Charles Yaketa, for whom this weekend's masses are offered. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us also remember all of those who are suffering from the virus, which is afflicting many nations. Let us also remember all of those who still perform the duties of care, of delivery, of food preparation. For all of those who at this time do not take cover, but come out for the good of all, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let's conclude the prayer together. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Alleluia.
Yeah.
praise and glory be to thee, for our good and the good of all the church.
Receive, O Lord, we pray, these offerings of your exalted church, and as you have given her cause for such great gladness, grant also that the gifts we bring may bear fruit in perpetual happiness. And all of this we ask through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us now give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just. Our duty and salvation at all times to acclaim you, O Lord. But in this time above all to laud you yet more gloriously, when Christ, our holy Passover, is sacrificed. By the oblation of his blood, he brings the sacrifices of old to fulfillment in the reality of the cross. And by commending himself to you for our salvation, shows himself to be the priest, the altar, and the lamb of sacrifice. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land, every people exults in your praise, and even the heavenly powers with the angelic host sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, once more giving thanks. He gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, bring her to the fullness of charity.
together with Francis I, our Pope, Edward Bernard, our Bishop Pro Tem, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the Holy Resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, to whom this church is consecrated, and Saint Joseph, with the blessed apostles, our patron saints, our Holy Father, Saint Benedict, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, may be merited to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Amen. May the precious blood of the good Lord keep us safe for eternal life. The communion antiphon. The disciples recognized the Lord Jesus in the breaking of the bread. Hallelujah. What passes our lips is food, O Lord, may be possessed in purity of heart. The
that what is given to us in time shall be our healing for eternity. Christ. Alleluia, alleluia.